And we got that announcement too. So give me just a second just to organize my screen. Okay, so I'll start by giving a general, a little bit of background about the Israeli Declaration of Independence before we'll plunge into the concept of freedom. So first of all, the declaration itself was pronounced on May 14th, 1948. It was pronounced and it was signed. The declaration itself has four main parts. The first part gives a general description on the Jewish people, the struggle to go back, like the Jewish people's struggle to return to the land of Israel. And there's a reference to the international acknowledgement of this right. Then there's the sort of official declaration about the establishment of the state of Israel. Then there's the third part in which there's a representation of the principles that will guide the new state. And we're going to focus today on this third section. The fourth section addresses the United Nations, the Arab people of the area, the Arab countries in the region, and the Jews in the diaspora. And basically, it's a round of one, two, three, four. Four references for people to join in the effort of the state and reaching out a hand for peace. Now there's a very interesting background for the declaration, because like the historical background is just to really very briefly refer to that, because it's worth a lecture in and of itself. The declaration is actually written and declared and signed during the War of Independence. I mean, at the time there was a war. And yet, reading it today, you have to admire the people who sat there and had sort of a vision for a state and for a document such as this. This is one interesting point of view to bear in mind. Another interesting, quite fascinating point of view is the fact that the word democracy does not exist in the Declaration of Independence. It's just not there. The word is not there. And the third thing is that actually, and this is really like a nice tidbit for whatever social event you have. When David Ben Gurion is reading the Declaration of Independence, he's actually reading from a bunch of like regular papers, and the scroll itself is actually empty. And he invites everyone to sign this empty scroll, which only about a week or two later is given to calligraphy artist to write it in the like very official and very beautiful way that it is written, that is it's presented today. Just to show you that there was really, I mean, with all the, how shall I say it? On the one hand, it was a very emotional and very official event, very meaningful in the history of Israel. That's on the one hand. On the other hand, it was literally done within the context of war. So David Ben-Gurion had quite a lot on his mind at the time while he was reading the Declaration of Independence. I would like also to refer to one last issue as part of this introduction, that in Israel today, the Declaration of Independence does not have a legal status. That is, it's not a law. However, it did and it still does serve judges in the Israeli High Court as reference and as a point of reference when they interpret the law. And in a minute, we'll read the main paragraph that refers to the principles of the Jewish state. And in this paragraph, it's very clear that the vision was a vision of equality and freedom for all. And in light of this vision, the Israeli High Court is using the Declaration of Independence as inspiration and as a point of reference when they interpret the law. And an interesting connection to the American Declaration of Independence is that if you read the first lines of "We, the Jewish people," it really sort of reverberates or echoes the American Declaration of Independence. So they did receive, you could argue that the writers of the Israeli Declaration of Independence did get at least some inspiration from the American Declaration of Independence. Now, to plunge into the specific section I'd like to discuss, and as I said, it's part of the third section of the Declaration of Independence, the part in which the principles of the state, the values the state will be based on are presented. And the specific paragraph says the following. The state of Israel will be open for Jewish immigration and for the ingathering of the exiles. It will foster the development of the country for the benefit of all its inhabitants. It will be based on freedom, justice, and peace, as envisaged by the prophets of Israel. It will ensure complete equality of social and political rights to all its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. It will guarantee freedom of religion, conscience, language, education, and culture. It will safeguard the holy places of all religions, and it will be faithful to the principles of the Charter of the United Nations. Now, out of all this paragraph, which can serve as the basis of several lectures, not just one, I chose to focus on one main sentence. The state of Israel will be based on freedom, justice, and peace as envisaged by the prophets of Israel. And there's the question, what is freedom? Like, when they talk about freedom, what do they mean? And I'd like to, and Jeremy, I'm not sure I have host abilities, but Jeremy, if you can unmute everyone.
People should be able to unmute themselves.
So we're just a minute. I'll just switch to gallery view so I'll see everyone. So feel free to just unmute yourself and let's have like a brief brainstorming on what is freedom.
Freedom. So freedom is something that's lacking in much of the world. It is an aspiration of people everywhere, I think. Mm-hmm. But the strong men, usually men, not always, have a way of suppressing it. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Well, Janis Joplin said it all. Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose.
Okay, thank you.
Me and Bobby McGee.
Yeah, Chris Christopherson wrote that one, of course.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I'm pretty sure. Pretty sure.
But it's
yeah,
it's a sarcastic statement.
Mm-hmm. How do you see it as sarcastic?
It's really one really is not free. One who has nothing left to lose is free.
Okay.
I think I've always understood freedoms in an American context, certainly, are the freedoms from disruption and the freedoms to do what you wish within the parameters. So sort of the rights to do, or to rights from being deterred from something, which is not something I would say is how Judaism works, but I think in the American context, certainly, that's how I've always understood freedom. Freedom from disruption, mm-hmm. freedom to do X, Y, and Z things.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Anyone else wants to share their thoughts about freedom?
And thanks, Jeremy, for infusing the Jewish, just the idea of distinguishing Jewish from general. We'll have our opinions and interpretations and knowledge, but the fact that you open that discussion theme or refer to that theme is very useful. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Elisheva, I think you wanted to talk, but could you unmute yourself?
My favorite quote, which is not legalistic about freedom, is "My freedom ends at your nose."
Your nose.
All of our listed freedoms end where they impinge on somebody else's freedom.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I think there was a very renowned American judge who said that once freedom ends where one's neighbor's nose begins. Like you're sort of, you're free to raise your hand up until the point where your neighbor's nose begins. Anyone else wants to share? Elisheva, thank you. So let me throw a couple of things following this discussion. In Hebrew, there are actually three words that describe freedom. Yes, Marian.
Yeah, I just had a thought about what Natan Sharansky said once, that when he was in prison in Russian, Siberia, whatever, and the guard said, I'm free and you're not, you're locked up here. And Sharansky said, I'm paraphrasing, I don't remember exactly, but no, you're not free because you have to do what your government says, you have to believe what they believe, and you must, and you're not free. I'm free to think whatever I want and believe whatever I want.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. So I'd like to point out that in Hebrew, there are three words for freedom. Two can be quite easily translated. The third one is a bit of a challenge. So the first one is chofesh, which is translated to freedom. The second one is chirut, which is translated to liberty. And in a minute, I'll touch upon a couple of interesting interpretations regarding the difference between freedom and liberty. The third one is dror. Now, dror in Hebrew refers to, again, for the lack of a better translation, it can be translated to as freedom. It also refers to a bird, a sparrow. And some of the interpretations that I'll bring take this bird as inspiration, if you will, to the interpretation of what freedom is. And going back to what Jeremy suggested, I'm not an attorney and I'm not a judge, so I'm not going to focus on the legal aspect of freedom, but I will try to touch upon some interpretations from Jewish philosophy and from the Talmud. And then we'll see how much time we'll have. We'll also touch upon issues that relate to freedom in Israel today. So first of all, let's differentiate between liberty and freedom. And here I'm using the work of Yeshayahu Berlin, who is a wonderful Jewish philosopher. And he actually talks about what he defines as negative liberty and positive liberty. Negative liberty is when there are no restraints. You can say that it's the freedom to do, or let's expand it, the freedom to do what you want with no restraints. And from this perspective, slaves are liberated. That is, they are liberated from slavery, therefore they are free to do whatever they want. But interestingly enough, he says this is negative liberty. Why is it negative liberty? Because it actually refers to what's lacking. That is, you're free. And here I'm translating from Hebrew, you're free from something. The positive liberty refers to the liberty to make meaningful choices. That is, not just to do what you will, but the liberty to fulfill oneself. And for this, you actually have to have the will to curb your own freedom at certain points in order to fulfill, if you will, like a higher purpose. So in that sense, to be free in the positive sense of the word, you have to have grit, you have to have perseverance, and you have to have the ability to regulate your emotions and to delay gratification. Now, if we'll take this, and Yeshayahu Berlin is very much quoted in almost any discussion over freedom, at least in Hebrew, in Israel. And there's an interesting interpretation by Professor Avi Sagi and Professor Yedidia Stern, and they speak about liberty and responsibility. And they speak about the Jewish state. And they actually, in a sense, they create a parable. They refer to the Jewish people being freed from Egypt, that is, the slaves being freed. But then they say, look, for generations upon generations, the warriors, and they're talking about Zionism here, Jewish people, Jewish Zionists yearned to have a free state. That is, in a sense, freedom from oppression and persecution. However, they say, this is only the first step in a very long way, because once you have a state, you also acquire responsibility. You cannot do whatever you want. You have to experience liberty in the positive sense of freedom. They don't go into political interpretations, but I'll let each and every one of you do that on your own according to your own beliefs. But basically, to take Elisheva's wonderful example, basically it means that when you have a free state, it does not mean that you can do whatever you want. You have other people to acknowledge. And remember that here we can go back to the Declaration of Independence, in which it stated that there will be justice and peace, equality of social and political rights, and I'll read the whole thing, otherwise I'll misquote it. Equality of social and political rights to all its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. Some people in Israel would say that there's still a long way to go to reach this higher, high ideal. Going back, just a minute. Going back to what I quoted from Avi Sagi and Yedidia Stern, I think this is something to be mindful of. I think that they give a very nice perspective to the fact that once you have a state, your work is not over. You still have to continue to maintain freedom. In order for freedom to last and to be enjoyed by everyone. Now, there are very interesting quotes by Ben-Gurion, because remember, I said in the beginning that the word democracy does not appear in the Declaration of Independence. And people actually ask themselves, okay, why was it done? Some people suggest, look, they were in a state of war. It's amazing that they managed to phrase such a document in such a situation, such dire straits. So that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is what Ben-Gurion says. Ben-Gurion said, I know, I'd like people to know, and that's from an interview. He said, I'd like people to know that just to become a state, just to have an official acknowledgement of your national rights is not enough. We still have quite a lot of work to do. And when he points out his ideal for the state, he says, we have to endeavor to be moral, to be humane, and to be a light for the nations, like Or Lagoyim, a light onto the nations, which is quite a high ideal. And when he's asked about in what way, how do we see democracy within Judaism, because the Declaration of Independence speaks a lot about Judaism, about the vision of the Jewish prophets and references to Judaism in other places. And there's another interesting interview. This is not from an interview, sorry. This is from Ben-Gurion's journal. And in his journal, he's speaking about Western democracies. And he writes, he says, well, I'm not that keen about Western democracy. I'm in favor of a Jewish democracy, just to be of the West or part of the West is not enough. I see Judaism as offering very special values about life, about liberty. And again, he quotes the prophets and he extends it in another document that he wrote, in which he says that even in countries in which, and remember, we're talking about, this is 1956, so communism is very much powerful at the time. And Ben-Gurion says, even in countries in which you have a government of the people, a government of laborers, it's not free of weaknesses. And he said that it's up to us to learn from other countries and from other movements, and to see what are the things that we'd like to take and to learn from them. However, we should remember that in Judaism, we have quite a lot of values that we can also use, and then we can sort of, or we should balance this one against the other, and then choose wisely. So in that sense, today, when people are thinking about the Declaration of Independence, and in recent years, there was a lot of public study of the Israeli Declaration of Independence, trying to figure out what are the values, what are the things that we can gather from it. So there's actually, and this is one suggestion of Eliezer Schwed, who argues that the state of Israel was established with the vision of combining between a Jewish identity and a democratic form, that is, Jewish values and a democratic state and democratic establishments and type of government. I'd like to add to this group of wise people that one could argue that the idea and I would also suggest the practice of democracy, we can also find it in the Talmud, because in the Talmud you have a group of people who are discussing, and yet you have the opinion of the majority and you have the opinion of the minority, and there aren't topics that are forbidden to discuss for the discussion. And when you look at the way that the Talmud served Jewish communities along the generations, each community chose a rabbi or a leader, and each community had its form of halakha. That is, in Judaism in general, there was never one law in the strict sense of the word that served everyone, or everyone were obliged to follow the same law exactly. There were always nuances and interpretations along the within various communities. Today, and I'll briefly refer to that. Today in Israel, there's a huge discussion over this question of whether communities have the right to define their own type of Judaism, or whether when we're talking about Israel as a Jewish democracy, there's one true type of Judaism that everyone should follow. And there's a lot of, there's quite a lot of discussion going on various levels, on specifically on halakha, so that's one point you can suggest on that, and from other perspectives on whether there should be one establishment that decides halakha for everyone. So there's a huge discussion going on. And we'll see. I mean, in years to come, we'll see what will come of this discussion. I'll just say that if you have comments, I saw someone writing something in the chat, which I didn't have time to see. So give me just a minute to open it up and read. And if you have comments, feel free to unmute yourself and ask. It's from Richard. You're saying that declaring state is a necessary but not sufficient condition for moving forward positively in the long run. In a sense, yes. I mean, I find this suggestion fascinating because on the one hand, you might think that once you declare that you have a state, your work is done. But basically, there's a suggestion that says that your work is just beginning because you have to maintain this state and you have to make sure that the values that you ascribe to the state will still continue to live on and not just remain written on the page. So from this perspective, yes, it's necessary but not sufficient.
Is it also a question of the difference where in the United States they want a separation of church and state, and in Israel it's totally different?
In Israel there's no separation of religion and state. And I'm saying this generally because it's true both to Judaism and to Islam and to Christianity. That is, if Jews, for example, all issues that are relating to marriage, to divorces, and to burial in Israel are done basically through religion institutions. But this is true for Jews, for Muslims, and for Christians. And yes, part of the discussion that I refer to when we talk about a Jewish democracy also has to do with the question of separation of religion and state. And there's a huge discussion because Judaism also has a national facet to this. So part of the discussion has to do with this question of, okay, so we're separating religion from state, but then would we remain a Jewish state? I'll just mention because it's well worth the whole lecture in and of itself. But yes, that's part of the discussion. I'd like to devote the rest of the time to talking about Dror, which is, I find this as both fascinating and challenging concept of freedom. And there's another reason I chose to discuss it, because the word Dror appears in, I lost the quote here, but I'll just say it from memory, when they talk about Shemitah, that is the seventh year, and when they talk about Yovel, which is the 50th year, like 7 times 7, they talk about Dror, V'kra'atem Dror ba'aret, that is the land will be free. And in the Jeremy, help me in translating here. When I say Yovel, it's the Jubilee year. It's the right way to translate. Thank you. And Elisheva, thank you too. So when we talk about the Jubilee year, the idea is that the land goes back to its owners and all the debts are erased. Now, I intentionally am not going to discuss the practical ways to do Shemitah, but I will bring some, what I find as some fascinating interpretations to the word Dror within the concept of both Shemitah and one other place where Dror appears. I'll go back to that in a minute. So when we talk about dror within the context of Shemitah, of the Jubilee year, there are several interesting interpretations. Rashi says that dror, or freedom in that sense, is the freedom to live wherever you want. Other interpreters go back to this, and then they go to the bird. Remember I said that there's a bird that's called dror in Hebrew. It's sparrow in English. And just again, to give context that has to do with Hebrew, dror, the root of dror is daled reish. And daled reish in Hebrew also means to dwell, to live in. And that's why it explains why their interpretations either go to a place of dwelling, which is the first interpretation, a person who can live or dwell wherever he or she wants to. The second interpretation has to do with the sparrow. And they give two interesting interpretations. They say the sparrow lives at home or in the field, that is, lives in like how farmhouses, or it lives in the field. It there's no difference as far as the bird goes, as long as it's free to come and go. And they go back, like when they give this interpretation, they go back to the land of Israel, because the Jubilee year is relevant only if you live in Israel. And they say, when you live in Israel, you choose your place of dwelling like the sparrow. You can live wherever you want, either in a home, a house, or in the field, like in a tent for the sake of. The Evan Ezra, and that's my interpretation, sort of in a sense goes a step forward. He says, well, a sparrow is free. Now, how do you see the like the extent to which it is free? Freedom is so important to this type of bird that when it is free, it sings and it flies. When it is captured by a human, it doesn't eat until it dies. That is, freedom is its core existence. Without freedom, it cannot live. And there's another beautiful interpretation. Just a second, let me just scroll down.
Karen, we can't see your, if you're sharing your screen, we can't see it.
Ah, it's not, I mean, I can share it. It's in Hebrew. I'm just translating from
just
Hebrew.
Just letting you know.
I'm not sure how useful it might be.
Just letting you know, that's all.
But I will share screen in a minute for one thing. So another interpretation is, and this actually combines the idea of a place of dwelling and being free. They say the word dror comes from dira. Remember Dalet Reish? That refers to a place of dwelling. Dira is an apartment. So again, you see the same root everywhere. The Dalet Reish repeats itself. And basically they say, a person who has an apartment, who owns an apartment, is free. Why are they free? Because they have a permanent place of residence. If you don't have an apartment, you're like a wanderer. You're always on the move. You're always on the road. And you cannot find rest for yourself, neither spiritually nor physically, which I find is a fascinating way to interpret freedom, because normally, well, at least in my mind, my first association about people who are wanderers is that they're free to come and go as they will. And here, they give a completely opposite interpretation and quite fascinating interpretation. They say, if you have a permanent place of residence, you're free because you have a place to rest your soul and to rest your physical body, which is an interesting way to think about freedom. And symbolically or in a wider sense, you can also take that and connect this with what we said about having a state. Once you have a state, after so many years of wandering around the world, the wandering Jew, you have a place to rest your soul and to rest your body. And another place, remember I promised two interpretations of Dror, one that has to do with the Jubilee year, the other one has to do with the temple. In the temple, and that's from Parashat Ki Tissa, in the, when they speak about the Ktoret is, they speak about perfumes and the smoke that rises, but it's a perfumed smoke.
Incense.
Thank you. So they speak about incense and in that context, the term is mor dror. Now, nobody really knows what it means in Hebrew, but there are some fascinating interpretations about this. One interpretation is by the Rabbah. And he says that this has to do with musk. Anyone who knows musk perfume knows that it comes from deer. Now, the interpretation here says that the musk, when it is taken from a deer that is free, like free wandering, this is the best quality type of perfume because it expresses the deer's life's energy. And you cannot extract this type of perfume from an animal in captivity. Like if you capture the deer and in captivity, you try to extract the musk. So again, the association is that if you're free to roam, then the perfume is the best perfume, and this is something worthy to bring to as incense. And now I'd like to, please tell me before I'm sharing, because I'd like to share something that occurred quite serendipitously this week, and I wanted to share it with a bit of an association to a freedom and what we discussed today. But please tell me first if you have comments or questions. I'll take that as a no. I'd like to tell you the story of, let me find home, just a second. Just a minute, I have to share screen first, just a minute. Give me a second to share screen. Anyone heard about Lucia Abelar? Do you see my screen? Okay. So Lucia Abelar is not Jewish. She participated this week in Uruguay Got Talent. She chose to sing Hatikva. That's the Israel's anthem. Now, when she was asked, why did you choose this song? She said, I chose it because it's very emotional and because it speaks about the Jewish people's yearning to be free. I'll play the song and then I'll give some background. Just a second. Can you hear it?
You need to raise the volume on it, Karen.
Oh, just a second. Give me a minute, I think I'll share screen again. I think I forgot I forgot to optimize the sound. Just a second, I'll do it again. Here it is. Now I think now you'll hear it much better. I hope you managed to hear it because I didn't see you when I was sharing screen. The interesting story behind it is that she's not Jewish, but she's performing in senior houses, and some of them have Jewish and Israeli people living there. And she said that she makes a point of getting to know the songs that they find meaningful, and she realized that this is a very meaningful song for the people she performed for. So she learned the song. She didn't tell anyone that that's the song that she's going to present in Uruguay Got Talent. But up until now, I think it got several tens and thousands of 30,000 shares. And she's getting letters from Jews all around the world saying thank you for performing the song. And the interesting thing she said is that when she was interviewed, she asked what's the word in Hebrew for libre? Libre in Spanish is free. And she was told chofshi. And she said, you know, I heard a performance of Rita. She's an Israeli singer. And when she said chofshi, she had a sigh. And that's how I guessed that this is the word free in Hebrew. And if you have the time and energy, if you look at Rita's performance, she really mimics her performance. It's interesting. So I thought it was quite a serendipitous occurrence that to have someone perform this song this week. Anyone wants to share comments or questions?
It's interesting that her interpretation of Tikva, where she emphasized certain phrases. Mm-hmm. She obviously understood the meaning of the words.
Mm-hmm. She is doing quite a great job, considering the fact that she's not Jewish and she doesn't speak Hebrew.
For the most part, she's pronouncing it well.
Yeah, remarkably well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, allowing for the Spanish accent.
Yeah, well, a good singer does translate whatever she's singing for herself, even if she doesn't speak the language, she or mm-hmm. he. That's what goes for opera singers too. they have to understand what they're saying. Yeah, very good.
You know, there are so many metaphors for freedom.
Right.
Especially in the music world. I mean, the metaphor right. that I mentioned earlier in me and Bobby McGee.
Right.
Hatikva contains several metaphors.
Mm-hmm. So that's what I found interesting, that she didn't take like going back to the Declaration of Independence. She didn't take independence or nationality. She took this yearning for freedom as the core issue in this in her performance of the song, which was quite a fascinating way of interpreting it.
There are so many songs that talk about freedom in very mm-hmm. many and different ways.
Right.
You mentioned
Richard, sorry for budging in. Jeremy rightly points out that we're almost on the point of closing. So I'd like to say thank you to everyone. This is also an opportunity for me to bid everyone goodbye, because I'm finishing my work at Kehilat HaKerem, and Julie will take over taking care of the rest of the classes and taking care of speakers from Kehilat HaKerem's end. Next week we're going to talk about freedom from the American perspective. I'm sorry, I'm senile with names. Reminding the name again.
Yeah, so next week we'll have Judge Nate Firestone speak with us from his vast, vast experience in the American legal system, sharing his views. I'm really excited about that. I also want to just take this opportunity to thank Karen on behalf of Beth Shalom and everybody here, not only for the hard work of preparing a session today and helping this this series come to be, but also to take a moment and relay profound gratitude for me personally and for what we're building together. We're building together a relationship between communities, not just individuals, right? I'm so grateful that Karen came to Israel and I got a chance to, oh, I'm sorry, Karen came here to Pittsburgh from Israel and I got a chance to see her in Israel. But it's not just about the two of us by any means, but really about what we're building together, right? What does it mean? You know, the question that we asked, the question that brings us together today in this discussion about freedom is also about how do we live in community? How do we live in community across continents? How do we remain in community when people are changing, right? When communities are also flowing in and out. How do we do this in a way that is an investment in the long term? And so I want to thank Karen not only for her hard work, but her sense of vision for what this relationship between two communities could be. And so while we're grateful certainly for her hard work in this particular project, we're also grateful for the path that she was able to set us on. And so on behalf of Beth Shalom, and I'm going to take on behalf of everybody else here, our profound gratitude and an excitement for you in whatever comes next, whatever that path, wherever that pathway takes you, we're grateful and we are better off having had you here with us. So thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
I'm very glad we're joining communities because it's been wonderful. And thank you, Karen. And thank you, Jeremy.
So
that are here with us.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you both for all the hard work, and we really appreciated it. And looking forward to what's coming.
It is fitting in some way that this program will be halfway done when Karen and I both move on from our roles, and all of us are in good hands with Julie and Rabbi Mark Goodman, who will join us for the second half, and we'll end there with the optimism of what comes next, which is our session with Judge Firestone next week. It's 2 o'clock our time, 10 o'clock your time, for those of you in Israel. And no, did I do it wrong? It's not 10, it's 9.
The other way around.
Nine, sorry. You know, it's math at the middle of the afternoon. What can you do for me? We didn't learn a lot of math in rabbinical school. In any case, have a wonderful rest of your day and week. I think Wednesday afternoon is probably early enough to say Shabbat Shalom in advance, and have a great day. And we'll be putting these videos up on the website so that people who weren't able to make the beginning or couldn't come to a particular session will have access to them. We haven't done it yet, but stay tuned. All that, the page, you know what, before we go, I'm going to just drop a link in the chat. Each session is registered separately. I know that can be very challenging or confusing. You are not alone in that, but we did that so that people would, it would be as secure as possible. And so you can find that information and the future videos we're gonna put on this website, this page, which holds this relationship we're doing right now. So thank you all, thank you, Karen. And have a wonderful rest of the day, everybody.
And Chodesh Tov,
Jeremy. Chodesh Tov. Right. Thanks, Jeremy. Thanks, everyone.
Be well, everybody.